Shalom and welcome to Jerusalem Studio. The Palestinian issue has dominated the Arab-Israeli discourse ever since the 1948 war. Excluding the Syrian angle, this virtually remains the last, yet most explosive issue blocking Israel from its aspired goal of peace with the entire Arab world. What are the chances for Israel to bypass the Palestinians and reach an accommodation with other Arab parties? To analyze this question, we're joined here by Lieutenant Colonel in Reserve Reuven Ben Shalom, who is a cross-cultural strategist and a columnist at the Jerusalem Post. Welcome. I'd like also to welcome our TV7 analyst, Mr. Amir Oren, and Mr. Dan Diker, who is a senior fellow and project on political warfare at the Jerusalem Center for Public Affairs. Welcome. I'd like also to welcome Yoni Ben Menachem, who is a Middle East expert and political analyst. Mr. Oren, give us a broader understanding on the latest developments pertaining to this topic.
The Palestinian issue has been both a context and a pretext for the larger Arab-Israeli conflict. Ever since, as you mentioned, the 1948 war, the Arab countries bordering Israel, even those which do not have a common border with Israel, such as Iraq or Saudi Arabia, have said that they are working for the establishment of some sort of justice for the Palestinians. In later years, a state for the Palestinians. Earlier, Jordan was in charge of the West Bank and Egypt was in charge of the Gaza Strip. At one time, Syria did not recognize the political aspirations of the Palestinians, saying that this is southern Syria of earlier times. But the Arab rulers find it a convenient excuse not to sign peace with Israel for fear of the reaction of the masses in their countries. But actually, they want to make sure that in any peace agreement between Israel and the Palestinians, the refugees or their descendants will be taken out of these countries because they would rather have them out of there and because they don't give them citizenship or other rights. They want them back home in Palestine.
Indeed. Colonel Ben Shalom?
I think the big question is, will we be able to have normalization and ultimately, you know, diplomatic relations with countries without solving the Palestinian issue? And there's a feeling like the Israeli administration feels that the more time progresses, this is possible. Now, of course, we went a long way, maybe 90% of the way as far as under the radar relations, a lot of commerce, intelligence, aligned interest with countering terrorism. But I don't think the countries around us will be able to one day say, okay, you know what? Without solving that, we now have diplomatic relations. They won't be able to pass this threshold. Now, they have a problem. It's not that they like the Palestinians. I think they don't like them. I think they resent them. I think that even if you go back to history, like the history of the Palestinians in Jordan, many Arab countries, I think, don't truly believe that the Palestinians aspire to reach statehood, which is an interesting point. But still, they have this stumbling block, mainly because of the masses, like Mr. Oren says. So I think we won't be able to pass that. So it's not that we can put that aside and move forward. And the question is, of course, is how far can we go with that? And if the Palestinian issue is not solved, you know, what's the ultimate aspiration that we can have as far as normalization in the region?
Mr. Diker?
You know, we've heard the term political football, and I think that my colleagues are absolutely right that the Palestinian issue has become the big political football in the Middle East. In fact, the Palestinians, by many of their fellow Arab powers, are really called the bastard children of the Arab world. They're, as Lieutenant Colonel said, they're unwanted, they're resented. And I think that today, what is very little known is that they're unwanted because they refuse to join the Arab Sunni establishment in coalescing against the Iranian regime and their Hezbollah and Hamas proxies. It's a major issue for the Arab world that the Palestinians have basically said, beginning with Mahmoud Abbas, the president of Palestinian Authority, and the other Palestinian seniors, we are the center of the Arab-Israeli conflict. We are the center of the problems in the Middle East. And the Arab Sunni establishment led by Saudi Arabia today are saying to the Palestinians privately, no, you're not. It's about the Iranian regime. And the Israelis, they say privately, are helping us and you're hurting us.
Mr. Ben Menachem?
Well, when we talk about the Palestinians, we're actually talking about two entities. One in Gaza Strip, which is very extreme and there's no any possibility for peace between Israel and Hamas in Gaza. They only coexist some sort of understandings. And as for the PA also, I don't think that it's possible with the leadership in Israel right now before the elections and with the leadership in the Palestinian Authority itself to reach some sort of a deal and break the deadlock. It's almost impossible. So all these slogans about normalization with the Arab countries, it's all, I think, Israeli propaganda. Because there might be some sort of a normalization under the table or behind the scenes and talking on security matters and coalition against Iran and so on. But I don't think that the Arab countries are willing to give up the Arab peace initiative, which is not acceptable for Israel. And as long as there's no breakthrough in that field, then there will be no normalization with Arab countries.
Mr. Oren, with regard to the Arab Initiative of 2002, which was formulated in Lebanon and was led predominantly by Saudi Arabia alongside Jordan, Egypt, and other countries that are hoping for some kind of solution, not necessarily of normalizing relations with Israel, but separating the Arab world from the Palestinians in the same way that Israel wants to separate from the Palestinians themselves, just with all those refugees living in different countries, not yet being part of the countries proper as citizens, but as more of the refugee status as put out by the United Nations. They are not interested in suddenly integrating all those masses into their own political systems. That is why also just several weeks ago, there was a conference of parliamentarians in Jordan where the foreign minister of Jordan was quite blatant that the Arab world needs to refocus their attention to the Palestinian issue, regardless of Israel's aspirations to normalize. There is no normalization of relations, as Yoni Ben Menachem said. Something needs to happen in order to bring the Palestinian people back to Palestine proper, as they put it. In other words, nothing has changed, or is this now fiction and Israeli propaganda, as we just hear?
Well, one has to look at the sources of intra-Arab intrigues. You used to have two or three stronger Arab powers, mostly Egypt. At some point, Syria joined them, but Syria was historically weaker. You had economically strong countries, which were militarily weak, the Gulf countries led by Saudi Arabia and the other sheikdoms and emirates and what have you. And you had small and weak countries such as Lebanon and Jordan. Now, Palestine, had it been created in 1947-48, after the UN General Assembly resolution, which was the basis for the creation of Israel too, would have joined the smaller, weaker Arab countries. And it would have been prey to the bigger powers because Egypt and Jordan fought. When they fought in 1948, when they invaded what has become Israel, they did it for their own sake, not for the Palestinians. They wanted to have a piece of the pie in Israel proper, along the Mediterranean, or in the West Bank. Now, having undergone all of the wars, and Israel having occupied Gaza and the West Bank, in a sense, it's these territories are in escrow now, waiting for the Palestinians to come to terms with Israel, at which time they will get some sort of control over them. The Arab countries have always said, even Iraq under Saddam Hussein, whatever the Palestinians say is good enough for them, it's going to be fine with us. We are not to be more Catholic than the Pope or whatever the Muslim equivalent is. And Israel tried first to reach an understanding with King Hussein. Later, Hussein found that Israel is only playing a game with him. So he announced in 1988 a disengagement from the West Bank and left Israel to negotiate with the Palestinian Liberation Organization. And actually, even after Oslo, we are back to square one regarding the Palestinian-Israeli debate.
Colonel Ben Shalom, is it fictitious, the whole improvement of relations with the Arab world between Israel and them due to the fact that the Palestinians will always remain an issue for them when it comes to their own personal interests? Or is it something that can only be, you know, limited on the matter of the Iranian threat when we're talking about those aspects? And to what degree does the Arab world, also Saudi Arabia in particular, which is known to have under the table a lot of relations with Israel on security-related issues, but then we hear that same week the king of Saudi Arabia speaking about how the Palestinian issue is in the forefront of everything that it is ongoing between the two countries.
I think sayings such as that are only to counterbalance other things that have been said. So if the prince says something about even recognizing Jerusalem as the capital of Israel, and then the Arab world starts talking about that, then they have to balance it with saying, oh yes, don't forget the Palestinians, and Jerusalem should be their capital, or East Jerusalem should be their capital. So I don't see that. I don't see that as an issue at all. On the contrary, I think it just shows how much they don't care about the Palestinian issue. Now, it sounds as if there's a disagreement here around the table, but I don't think that's so. I'll say again that I think that full diplomatic open relations with these countries will never be achieved without solving the Palestinian issue. But I really believe that these countries don't care. I think when they analyze it, even when they look at the level of suffering, the level of the level of living throughout the Middle East, they say the Palestinians, they have it good. By the way, the Gaza situation isn't the best, but that's ruled by Hamas, as we said. The Palestinian Authority have self-governance. Is their lifestyle the worst in the Middle East? Certainly not. Many even envy them. Even looking at the refugee camps in some of the countries in the region, there's a lot of resentment towards what happened there. These people come here, live at the expense of the world, billions of dollars pouring in for so many years, a lot of resentment. So I don't think the Arab world really, in their heart, mind what happens here and aspire to this Palestinian dream. Another issue that's maybe a bit sensitive for me as an Israeli to say, because I respect my Palestinian neighbors, I must say that. But the Arabs know their history. So they know that 100 years ago there was no such thing, the Palestinian people. Okay, they know this is a relatively new invention. It's not like they really have these sentiments of returning some justice of hundreds of years that people were torn for their homeland. They understand what happened here. And I think most of the countries in the region accept that history took its course. You know, we could talk about the Golan Heights with Syria. We could talk about Haifa and Jaffa. But everyone knows, even Mahmoud Abbas knows he's not going back to his home.
But isn't that also a Palestinian domestic discussion where the Palestinian Authority wants to make it a Palestinian national issue?
They must.
As opposed to Hamas, which says, no, it's not a Palestinian issue per se. It's more of an Islamic issue where the Jews have occupied Islamic lands that were occupied by the Muslims for many, many years, and now suddenly Jews came and took that over. So
yes,
to what degree is that also perceived in such a manner in the Arab and Muslim world?
That's what's interesting here, that I think the Palestinians were one of the only ones that still cling to this imaginary narrative of ousting the infidels, the descendants of apes and pigs, which is us. And I think most of the Arab world don't see it that way. I must also remind us that the Arab world, there's a difference between the leadership and the masses. Jordan, for instance, we have very intimate relationship, aligned interests, very good cooperation. The masses in Jordan hate our guts. It's not easy. I hope someday we can work through that. But, you know, it's not like the masses in the Arab world love Israel and hate the Palestinians. It's not that simple.
Mr. Diker, when we're talking about the narratives, obviously the leadership, as Colonel Ben Shalom has stated, also has an interest of maintaining strategic ties or a strategic alliance under the table with the State of Israel in order to stand against the Islamic Republic of Iran, as you earlier stated. To what degree do you think that this is detached from the population, or even the parliament that represents the population only to a certain extent, as many parliaments are not even chosen by the people?
Well, I think that's the key point. I think we started this segment by saying that the 30 or so Arab parliaments that gathered in Jordan for the IPA, I'm going to expose a secret, and that is that the crisis point in this whole Palestinian issue is not between the Palestinians and Israel only, it's between the Palestinians and the Jordanians. Because if you look at the text of the IPA proceedings. What did His Majesty King Abdullah say time after time after time? The Hashemite kingdom will remain the custodians of the Muslim holy sites in Al-Quds, in Jerusalem. And I would submit to you that the entire reason that he hosted this interparliamentary assembly is to publicly confirm and affirm the Hashemite role in Jerusalem, which the PLO rejects. The PLO will, starting with Arafat and going through Abu Mazen through Mahmoud Abbas, has said time and time again that they will be the only sovereign, religious sovereign, over the Muslim holy sites. So that the explosion and the conflict is really between the Hashemite kingdom and the PLO, not between the PLO and Israel. It's a very important point, because when people talk about the resistance point at which there can't be an agreement because Israel, because of one reason for Israel, the other reason for the PLO, that's the real issue in Jerusalem, is between the two of them. Having said that, the strategic relationship between Jordan and Israel is very strong. It has been said by not only by General Amos Gilad, but others, leading security thinkers in Israel, that Jordan's eastern border is Israel's security border, meaning any penetration of that border will be considered by the Israeli security establishment a strategic threat to the state of Israel. And let's remember that the United States plays several billion dollars towards the Muhabarat, the security apparatus in Jordan. And so this triangular relationship between the United States, security relationship, United States, Israel, and the Hashemite Kingdom of Jordan, very strong, and Jordan has done an excellent job in the meantime of guarding its border and keeping its border between itself and Israel, which is Israel's longest border, peaceful and stable.
Nevertheless, when we're talking about that specific conference, also the foreign minister of Jordan once again called at the same time that the normalization of the Arab world with Israel should be adjacent to the normalization and finding a solution to the Israeli-Palestinian conflict, calling on the Muslim world to stop any advancement of normalizing relations with the Jewish state. So there is somewhat of a two trajectory here.
Yeah, there's talk and there's action. And in the action, let's remember, in Arab culture, and you know, you have great experts here on Arab and Islamic culture, symbolism is everything. And therefore the notion that, and in my view, the best normalization there can be is normalization that's not public normalization. We are today in 2019 probably in the best position. I mean, the Middle East as a network, as a system of states in which there is no regional security system in place, and Israel has become de facto the security anchor for the what's left of the Arab state system. Funny enough,
Mr. Ben Menachem,
I disagree with my dear friend Mr. Diker concerning the rivalry between the PLO and Jordan about the holy places in Jerusalem, and especially the Temple Mount. I think that because both Jordanians and Palestinians are very worried from this plan of peace plan of President Trump, the deal of the century, which is called the deal of the century, I think that we now see a coordination between Mahmoud Abbas and between King Abdullah, in order to torpedo this peace plan, especially concerning the status of Jerusalem and the Temple Mount, because Jordan is officially the custodian of the holy places in Jerusalem, based on the peace agreement between Israel and Jordan from 1994. King Abdullah is insisting to lead the battle against this peace plan of Trump over Jerusalem and over the Temple Mount. And this is the reason that we see now what is happening in the Temple Mount concerning Bab el-Rahme, which was a planned move by the Jordanian king.
Known as the Golden Gate.
Yes, the Golden Gate, in order, Bab el-Rahme, in order to sabotage the peace plan of Trump and to just send this signal to the Americans and the Israelis, look, we are the ones who have the sovereignty here in the Temple Mount, not Israel, don't even dream about it. And this is what caused Jordan to initiate this move in the Temple Mount. And now the Palestinians are joining. And what we saw, the throwing of the cocktail molotovs and the riots in the Temple Mount, is now the Fatah in Jerusalem is joining the Jordanians that were leading this crisis. And now they're joining together. And this is a long story. And I think that Israel should do everything which is possible to solve this issue, because this might lead to an escalation. The Temple Mount is a very sensitive place. It's like a dynamite which can cause a big intifada. And this is why we have to solve it very soon. And what I see that the Israeli government, I don't think they're doing enough. I don't understand exactly the severity of the situation. And King Abdullah now is in Washington. This is a good opportunity for Israel to put pressure on him through the Americans in order to find some sort of a solution to what is happening in the Temple Mount. If it will not be solved in the coming days, this will be a big escalation all over.
Specifically on the Temple Mount, Mr. Oren, King Abdullah indeed went to the United States in order to garner Congress support, not necessarily the Trump administration itself, but to go to Congress, seek out Democratic...
Yeah, but he met with the...
Of course, he met
Pompeo
with...
And
yes,
and
indeed.
Kushner and,
but his main focus was to go and garner exactly. Congress support yeah. in order to try and convince Congress to... apply more pressure on Israel in order to bring about the Muslim demands of the Waqf and, for that matter, also the Hashemite Kingdom of Jordan.
But there's a domino theory here. It is true that the Hashemites don't want the Palestinians to be considered masters of the Mount, but the Saudis don't want the Jordanians to be considered sole custodians. So you have the three monarchs, the Moroccan, the Saudi, and the Jordanian, much like the three kings in...
Also Turkey wants to be
in
the,
Christian, yes.
Erdogan.
Erdogan is not yet yeah. the Sultan, but what you have is the committee of the three monarchs. And it seems as if the region is out of sync with how this whole started. Because when the conflict between Israel and the Palestinians, not pre-state, but the state of Israel, when it started... There were colonial or imperial powers here, and there was a struggle for domination in the pan-Arabic dimension, mostly Gamal Abdel Nasser in Egypt versus Iraq and Syria and all the rest. This is ancient history now. And the question, Colonel Ben Shalom earlier alluded to the Jews coming back to the land of Zion after hundreds and thousands of years. One may say that for Egypt and others, the issue of Palestine is a sort of, if I forget thee, O Palestine, let my right hand be forgotten too. This is just a footnote, an asterisk. They don't really put it as a condition. Peace with Egypt was not contingent on full and immediate peace between Israel and Jordan or Israel and the Palestinians. The Egyptians, Sadat and later Mubarak, and even now Sisi, they wouldn't want to have the impression in the Arab world that they have deserted the Palestinians. But they do not go out of the way to help them, and they do not say, if you don't sign with the Palestinians, we are going to keep our belligerency with you.
Colonel Ben Shalom.
Well, first, interesting conclusion that the Middle East is a mess, but we always knew that, and there is no clear solution. I think the Palestinians now have the situational assessment, and I think that their conclusion is that they're in trouble. For years, I felt like we're the ones that are running out of time. The time is on their side, and they were garnering support, going to roundabout ways, going to the UN, etc. Now I think they feel they're losing the Arab world. Nobody cares. I said before, even technically, they are not the ones that are suffering in the Middle East. And I think they're afraid that the time will come where their issue will just be off the table. So I think they must be very pressured now, and I think rightfully so. But I don't think for one second that Israel can just say, you know, we can go on forever. I think the Israeli right-wing government right now, their policy, their strategy, is to wait it out. I think they feel the more they wait, the better for us. I think that if we don't solve the Palestinian issue, we're never going to have happy neighbors. If we don't have happy neighbors, we're not going to be happy. So I think ultimately our ultimate goal is to solve this, is to push this forward. So what I wish is that the Arab world, the Arab community, would be able to support the Palestinians, get together and lead them in the right way. And it's not for one second that I, as an Israeli, want the Palestinians to be abandoned.
Well, we're drawing near to the end of the program, so I'd like to give each and every one of you a closing, the opportunity to have a closing statement with somewhat of an anticipation for the future. Mr. Ben Menachem, we'll start with you.
I think that Palestinian leadership is waiting and eager to see a change in the regime of Israel, and they want to get rid of Benjamin Netanyahu, hoping that the new leadership in Israel, if they will be elected, of course, or will form the new coalition, that they will go for some sort of renewing the dialogue and the peace process. This is the only hope they have. I agree with my colleague that they are very afraid of what is happening, and then they are losing not only the support of the Arab world, they're also losing the territories because the settlements are growing, and then they are afraid that they'll have nothing to negotiate on.
Mr. Diker?
I think finally one point that hasn't been made and needs to be made is that you're seeing more and more in the context of anti-normalization in calls in the Arab world and from the Palestinian leadership, you're seeing exactly the opposite on the ground in the West Bank. You're seeing greater and greater normalization. You're seeing a revolution in Palestinian middle class, especially in Area C, and therefore you're seeing a tension point between the Palestinian leadership that is doing everything it can to isolate Israel, to boycott Israel, and on the ground, the exact opposite is happening. That, in my assessment, is the key to peace, ground-up peacemaking, using economics, cooperation, dignity between Israelis and Palestinians. I think that's the direction we need to take.
Colonel Ben Shalom?
I think we get used to a reality as if America is Trump, Israel is Netanyahu, and Abbas is the Palestinians forever and ever. Soon, all three of them will not be in power. What's soon? A year? 5 years? And then, if we are wise enough to elect women to leadership roles throughout the Middle East, we'll have peace. And it's not a joke.
Well, who knows? Maybe there'll be a new Golda, maybe. Mr. Oren?
A new Golda, a new Indira Gandhi. They weren't the softest of
indeed.
Of leaders. Now, we are more than 25 years into the Oslo process, which started when the Palestinians were at an historic low. And, of course, it's tempting to negotiate with your partner when the other side is in a position of weakness. But we shouldn't go too far about that, because if they have their backs to the wall, we could have an explosion.
Well, that's all the time that we have for today, so I'd like to thank Colonel Ben Shalom, Mr. Oren, Mr. Diker, and Mr. Ben Menachem for being here today. And I'd like to thank our viewers as well, and we will see you next time.
You just watched TV7 Jerusalem Studio. We encourage you to pray for the challenges raised in today's program. If you were blessed by our production, please consider supporting TV7 Israel. The details of our respective bank accounts for donations from Europe and the United States appear on the screen. Your generosity allows us to continue to serve God's calling, to broadcast content that truly matters through TV7 Israel from Jerusalem.